Hachette Audio presents Miracles on the Hardwood, the hope and a prayer story of a winning tradition in Catholic college basketball. Written by John Gasaway, read by Adam Verner. Author's note. It is a truth universally acknowledged that Catholic schools are good at college basketball. When such programs do well over the first weekend, or especially the first 2 weekends of an NCAA tournament, feature stories are duly written up explaining how this proficiency came to be. So far, the overarching run of success from Tom Gola and Bill Russell, through Dave Gavitt and John Thompson, all the way down to Mark Few and Jay Wright, would seem to support such an interpretation. Coach Wright once said that basketball in the Big East, a conference inextricably, though not exclusively, associated with the Catholic religion, is like a religion. My hope is that this book might shed a bit of light on the American paths of both faiths. It takes an army of players, coaches, scouts, doctors, trainers, and bottle holders to make up a football team. 2 or 3 good players, plus a few spares, and a coach who doesn't drink on the job, can make up a winning basketball team. And that can happen to a small school, as well as a large one. San Francisco Examiner, 1956. Introduction. Parish and Plains. On the day after her 100th birthday in 2019, Sister Jean Dolores Schmidt received a visitor in her office and talked about college basketball. Sister Jean had become a household name as chaplain for a Loyola Chicago team that made a surprise run to the 2018 Final Four. When she was asked by a reporter at that year's NCAA tournament what it was like to wake up and find oneself a national celebrity, she edited the question before answering it. International celebrity. In her office that day, Sister Jean shifted effortlessly between discussing the X's and O's of the 2018 Ramblers and dissecting Loyola's national champions from 1963. She had observed both teams at close range, and as a basketball addict, her knowledge extended well beyond the Ramblers. Sister Jean spoke perceptively of Bill Russell at San Francisco, as well as of the St. John's teams of the 1950s. She could cite chapter and verse from all of the above, based not on research conducted decades after the fact, but on the real-time observations of an enthralled fan. Speaking with Sister Jean about any 20th century event leads to a quick mental calculation of her age at the time in question. When Pearl Harbor was attacked, she was already teaching at a parochial school in Southern California. She was born less than 30 years after James Naismith invented the game of basketball, and her spectating predated the creation of both the National Invitation and the National Collegiate Athletic Association tournaments. The joy that Sister Jean found in watching basketball, and the contentment in her voice when noting that Loyola is the only team from Illinois ever to win the NCAA tournament, we're very proud of that. We're both unmistakable. She's also been impressed by what she's seen from Catholic programs more recently, and from Villanova in particular. Consider one pocket history of 21st century Catholic college basketball. Villanova won 2 NCAA titles. Gonzaga reached the national championship game. Loyola Chicago made its run to the Final Four. And Marquette and Georgetown appeared in national semifinals in their own rights. During this same span, Xavier earned a number one seed and reached no fewer than 3 Elite Eights, while St. Joseph's also received a top seed and entered the tournament with a 27-1 record. Wooden awards have been won this century by players from St. Joe's, Jameer Nelson, Creighton, Doug McDermott, Villanova, Jalen Brunson, and Dayton, Obi Toppin. Nor will we ever know what might have transpired in a 2020 NCAA tournament that was never played, one in which Gonzaga and potentially Dayton might have earned top seeds. Perhaps the first element to note in such a thumbnail is that so many of the programs named, all of them, actually, except Villanova and Dayton, represent Jesuit institutions. This prominence is a feature not only of Catholic basketball, but perhaps additionally of Catholic higher education as it's commonly perceived. While they are a populous and visible presence, Jesuit institutions, or indeed those of any one order, do not constitute a majority of Catholic colleges and universities in the United States. Nevertheless, the frequent conflation of Catholic with Jesuit persists among the general public, and college basketball is likely one significant contributing factor. There are nearly 250 Catholic institutions of higher learning in the United States, of which less than 20% play Division I basketball. For Jesuit colleges and universities, conversely, that figure is closer to 80%. With but a few exceptions, like Rockhurst in Kansas City, Regis in Denver, and John Carroll near Cleveland, a Jesuit campus tends to be synonymous with men's team that plays D1 basketball. The 11-member Big East Conference alone includes no fewer than 4 Jesuit programs. Jesuits are far less ubiquitous in the halls of the Association of Catholic Colleges and Universities than they are on ESPN. When Loyola faces DePaul, or when Fordham plays Manhattan, there are priestly bragging rights on the line in these clashes between different Catholic orders. Today's successful Catholic programs might fairly be said to stand on the shoulders of 20th century giants, Mikan, Cousy, Gola, Russell, and Baylor, not to mention Gavitt, Thompson, Massimino, Ewing, Mullen, Gathers, and Kimball. The story of that success is by turns inspiring, surprising, troubling, and illuminating. It is, above all, a story that is both American and Catholic, despite its setting within a sport invented as a means of proselytizing by a Presbyterian from Canada. Catholic colleges embraced Naismith's game in its infancy and never looked back. Hundreds of colleges of all types, sizes, and affiliations did the same, of course. It's a mark of Naismith's genius that he created a sport whose numerous and dissimilar adherents competed so avidly to be seen as its foremost disciples. In this rivalry dating to the sport's earliest years, we can glimpse the emergence of 2 distinct traditions of college basketball that have proven to be remarkably durable. These differing variants within the game may be termed the Parish and Plains varieties of the sport. They are far from the only such traditions within college basketball, and these nominal opposites are in fact alike, and ultimately constricted by the fact that both were uniformly white in their origins. The 2 traditions are the direct result of a creation story that is itself dichotomous. Naismith invented what is, among its many perfections, the perfect city sport. He was inspired in part by a game he played in the great outdoors as a child on a farm, Parish and Plains. At first glance, the 2 traditions may appear to have reversed their respective real-world roles. The Catholic Church dates back 2 millennia. Yet within the confines of a mere game, invented just 100-some years ago, it is the Plains tradition that holds pride of place. In basketball terms, it beat the Parish tradition to the spot. The sport itself was created under the auspices and, indeed, at the specific behest of the Young Men's Christian Association. No less a Plains giant than Kansas head coach Fog Allen himself took the lead in establishing the National Association of Basketball Coaches in 1927. No less a college basketball landmark than the NCAA tournament itself was proposed by Ohio State coach Harold Olson, with Allen's enthusiastic and crucial backing, as a response to the Parish tradition's inaugural National Invitation Tournament. It is the Plains tradition that can claim the closest thing college basketball has to a recognized apostolic succession dating back to the creation, Naismith, Allen, Adolf Rupp. The Plains tradition embraced Baroque administrative hierarchies and ex cathedra dictates to an extent befitting Rome in the time of Pope Leo XIII. In place of bishops, cardinals, and a pontiff, the Plains school of thought installed athletic directors, conference commissioners, and, at the pinnacle of the edifice, NCAA executive director Walter Byers. All the while, in the bounded earthly sphere of college athletics, Catholic programs were displaying as much iconoclasm and independence as any 17th century Puritan. For years, Catholic programs eschewed membership in the NCAA, and for even longer, they held off on joining conferences. Notre Dame still fights that second battle, in football, of course. But even the proud acolytes of fighting Irish exceptionalism were brought to heel eventually in basketball. The NCAA rather quickly mopped up all resistance with what became its irresistible tournament. As late as 1970, Al McGuire and Marquette famously loosed one last elegiac blast of rebellion by turning down a bid and choosing the NIT instead. It was a doomed gesture of defiance. Within 7 years, McGuire would secure his place in the coaching pantheon by winning the tournament he once spurned. In college basketball terms, all souls now profess fealty to the Church of the NCAA. Naturally, the distinction between the Parish and Plains traditions isn't always tidy. Early NIT champions included Colorado, West Virginia, Kentucky, and Utah. Georgetown and Holy Cross both reached the national title game in the NCAA tournament's first decade, with the latter winning it all. In the same vein of stubborn facts, there is St. Louis University. As early as 1937, the Billikens were members of the Missouri Valley Conference. With SLU's 1948 NIT title, the Jesuits had forged a winner west of the Mississippi, with a coach who was a native of Reynolds, Nebraska. Nevertheless, a cognizance that college basketball was in large part built on Plains foundation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.